Great to have you back on The Breakfast here on Plus TV Africa. And now let's go to Off the Press, where we have a review of the major stories making headlines across Nigeria today. I'm kicking off with the Punch newspapers, and we'll be on your screen in just a few seconds. A big one there is referring to the Northern Governor's opposition. It says, anger trails Northern Governor's opposition to 2023 power shift. Governor's demand for South presidency in 2023 unconstitutional, says the Forum. And it says here, Northern Governors working towards Nigeria's breakup, says Ohaneze. Regional governors paying lip service to Nigeria's unity. And that is from Afenifere. Petrol subsidy hits 905.27 billion naira. Oil rises to $79 a barrel. And also, Mambila Power Project construction begins before 2022, says the Senate. We are investigating extortion of inbound travelers at airports. And that's from the federal government. Also on the Punch, e-Naira offers cheaper, fast remittance options, says the CBN. And federal government spent 1.3 trillion on agricultural imports in 6 months. That is from the NBS. A few other stories on the Punch this morning. 74% global youth population in Nigeria. Nine others in 2041, sorry. 48 killed in Kaduna fresh attacks. So Kapu blames police. One dies, 16 rescued as Lagos boat hits rock. And group floods Oshun with Oshimbajo's 2023 presidential post. We can also find here PDP knocks Ogun government over Abiodun deputy speaker's foreign trips. Those are the stories we can take on the Punch.
From the Punch newspaper, let's go to the leadership. 2023 presidency. Northern governors, traditional leaders reject power shift. Slam Southern governors over stance on zoning. Call for caution over VAT controversy. Urge armed forces to sustain onslaught against terrorists. Rivers Lagos say they await for Supreme Court pronouncement. Above that headline on the leadership, Brent crude nears $80 as supply tightens across regions. Troops repel attack. Eliminate several bandits in Sokoto. Fans shot Kebbi Airport over 33 million naira debt. Electoral Act, Saraki CSOs urge National Assembly to act in national interest. COVID-19, FG decries extortion of travelers at airports. Also on the leadership newspaper, secrecy in government undermining access to information. That's according to the NGE, says presidency, NAS are major culprits.
All right, let's move away from the leadership now and see what we can find on the Daily Independent. Experts list 5G technology snags, want realities embraced. Ohaneze asks Southeast governors to launch Ibubiagu security outfit. An e-transmission of results, NCC can't dictate to us, says INEC. On insecurity, we need Berlin kind of walls at our borders, Navy tells reps. Court orders AGF to take over prosecution of former Imo governor. Northern governors reject rotation of presidency, back FG on value-added tax. Sitatom hoodlums set vehicle carrying vegetables ablaze in Enugu. An electoral act, Saraki urges National Assembly panel to act in national interest. Still on the Daily Independent, elite in danger over insecurity, Ingege laments. $600 billion siphoned from Nigeria from 1960 to date. Those are the ones on the Daily Independent.
Okay, let's now turn to the next newspaper. Let's look at The Nation. The story says, North's governors, emirs, reject power shift in 2023. It will be unconstitutional. Akeredolu says they have a right to their opinion. 42 killed, houses razed in Kaduna attacks. Mob lynched police, Lagos police chief won't die in vain, says CP. Government raises visitation panel for Lasso. 7.5 million doses of COVID-19 vaccines expected. Ohaneze seeks end to killings, arson in southeast. Let Ibubiagu function. Araome speaks as NNPC board chair, good for zone. Ekiti community is cut off as link bridge collapses. UI names Bursa. Also, sit at home traders devise means to recoup losses. And 13 wedding guests die in crash. Those are the stories on the Nation newspaper. Let's now say hello to our guest, Mr. Chris Nwandu, publisher of CKN News. Good morning. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
So across the papers, the story that we see is regarding the meeting by the Northern Governors in Kaduna yesterday. And it's saying that the Northern Governors basically have rejected a power shift to the South in 2023, saying it is unconstitutional and that they back the federal government on VAT. What do you say?
Fantastic. Good. Nice one, I would say. I'm not shocked, and neither am I surprised, but it has always reaffirmed my belief several, which I've always expressed, that the northern politicians seem to be more smarter, quote and unquote, smarter than their southern counterparts. And when it comes to big politics, they have a way of uniting within themselves and taking decisions which is in their own personal interest or their own best interest, to the detriment of other parts of the country, especially the South. It's only the South that always have an issue. Unity has never been a problem of the North. They are well united, irrespective of whatever you feel. Come to think of it, the chairman of that governor's forum is from the North Central. And so it is not that he's speaking. And this goes to show, and it's good. It's good that the leaders of the South are seeing what is happening. Because I remember vividly what happened in 2015. Practically most of them connived and ganged themselves in making sure that a Southern president was supposed to go for a second term, didn't have that second term. And they vehemently refused him. They said all sorts of things about him. He was clueless, he was terrible, he's this, he's that, and the rest of them. And that was an opportunity for the South to have a second shot at the president under Goodluck Jonathan. But they didn't do the needful. They joined forces with the North and picked a Northern presidential candidate, the president of President Muhammadu Buhari, who eventually won the election. They believe that, and then it's the North never said anything about power rotation. They did about being unconstitutional. They were sticking to the fact that, oh, the start you had your turn. Let us worry that even that of the North that was started by Yaragua was not finished. That Goodluck Jonathan finished the tenure of this. So that is the turn of the North. Then all of them were in unity and made sure that that narrative goes. But now it has come to the the power is supposed to rotate back to the South. All of them have come together to say, oh, now it's unconstitutional for anybody to say that. But let us also put in perspective, is there anything in the Constitution that says that the presidency must rotate back to the South? There is nothing in the Constitution that it must be torn by the North will take it, South will take it. It is only a political arrangement by the political parties, which was started in 1999 by the PDP and other parties then, that, okay, for better understanding, for fair play, equity and fair play, let the North, the South stay, which was now taken by Obasanjo. After the South, then the North will also have its turn. But if the Northern governors are not being economical with the truth, and they should know that this has been the policy, that it's after 8 years, as it were, that definitely the South is supposed to have its turn. But that is for the, they are saying Northern governors, which means that it's across body party line. So it's not only the APC that I'm talking about, it's both the APC and the PTP governors from the North that are saying that the power, there shouldn't be any power rotation, that we should stick to the Constitution. But as I said earlier, it's so obvious that the Northern politicians are much smarter, quote unquote, than their standard counterpart. And let's wait and see how this pans out.
All right. Mr. Wandu, in the same state where this meeting was held, there's a report of 42 lives that were lost in Kaduna Fresh crisis. So while the governors were meeting, I guess some bandits, hoodlums, terrorists were also busy. So I want you to, you know, quickly respond to that. It says 48 killed in Kaduna Fresh attacks. Sokapu blames police. And this is on the Punch newspapers this morning.
My condolences goes to the families of the bereaved, and may their souls rest in peace. But their souls will not rest in peace until the perpetrators of this evil are apprehended, and dealt with comprehensively. That is on one part. Second part is, well, I'm waiting to see what Asiri Elrufai is going to say, because from information we had, the killing was alluded to Fulani herdsmen and certain bandits. That has not been fully confirmed. But if that is the narrative, then that brings to question the statement issued by the Kaduna State Governor a few days back, that the anti-grazing law being enacted by the southern governors that we know that is not tenable, that the law cannot be implemented at the rest of them. He was deriding the southern governors for taking the measures to secure their various states. Now, you can see what is happening in states. He has no solution to the problem in Kaduna State. Kaduna has become a killing field for bandits, terrorists. I don't even like using the word, as I always say on this program. It has become a home to terrorists. And the governor is totally, is handicapped. He doesn't even know what to do again. On a daily basis, his people are being killed. Students are being kidnapped in Kaduna State on a daily basis in their tens and hundreds. And the governor practically is not being able to do anything about it. What do you see him saying? Oh, the southern governors are just playing to the gallery. The issue of the open grazing law is not enabled and blah, blah, blah. He's not removing his log in his own eyes and just looking at the place in other people's eyes. So let us write up to the occasion. He's the chief security officer of Kaduna State. The security of life and properties of people of Kaduna State rests solely on his laps. Let him do the needful and secure his people rather than just going and blaming other governors who are doing all they can to be able to secure their own people through the enactment of some of these laws, which they see. Be able to nick in the butt the various killings that is happening in their states. So as I say once again, my condolences to the families of the disease. But you can rest assured that this might not be the last of it. Kaduna has become a killing field, and the governor seems to have pissed about this.
Okay, so on the Punch newspaper, there's a story on the top right corner that says the federal government spent 1.3 trillion naira on agricultural imports in 6 months. That's according to the National Bureau of Statistics. So when I took a closer look at the story, it said that Nigeria basically was importing things like durum wheat. We're importing mackerel, herrings, edible mixtures, crude palm oil, malts, and these things are imported from countries like Canada, Denmark, Russia, and France. And when we keep talking about Nigeria being the giant of Africa with all our agricultural blessings, so to speak, would you say it's an irony that we're importing as much as 1.3 trillion naira worth of agricultural goods in just the first 6 months of the year?
Did I say Nigeria is the giant of Africa? Nigeria is an elephant with a clip. There is nothing giant about Africa. Even smaller countries like Ghana are doing far better than Nigeria. So I think we should stop deluding ourselves with that narrative that Nigeria is no giant. The giants of Africa know themselves. We can call them South Africa, Ghana, Rwanda. These are, I can see my brother smiling there. Those are giants because for you to call yourself a giant, there are certain indices that you must be able to meet. That is what qualifies you. It's not by your size. It's not by your number. It has indices, indices by the world body that determines who a giant is or who not. Nigeria is an elephant with clay feet. But back to the question of agriculture. It's very unfortunate that the gain that we made in the last few years has been totally eroded. We made so much gain, especially in the area of agriculture, which we look as an alternative to our oil revenue that was mainly due to the year. And I remember what the last regime did. Don't forget what prepared someone like Adesina to where he is today because of his achievement as a minister of agriculture. You knew where the issue of rice got to. You knew where the issue of cassava got to. You knew the issue of palm oil. You remember so many others that we were making so much input in the area of agriculture that we even started exporting. But that over the years, in the past 6 years, have been completely eroded. We are paying this service to agriculture, which to me would have been an alternative for us. We wouldn't have been suffering what we are suffering now, if not for the issue of just depending on just only oil. But also beyond that, it's also the issue of insecurity. Farmers are not good. People are not going to be farmers again. Fulani herdsmen and their cohorts at killing people at will, bandits at kidnapping, terrorists on the prowl, killing people. So people get afraid to go back to the bar, and that is the problem we are having. So if you can also handle the issue of insecurity, that is a aspiral effect over and above every other aspect of human life, be it socially, physically, economically, or whatever, even politically. That is where we find ourselves now. So that we are facing so much reporting is not news to me. I'm sure we've reported more than that. They are just being economical with the truth. But the fact remains that this is not the way to go. This government in 2015, when we are coming in, said that one of their priorities is going to be the area of agriculture and also be able to diversify the economy of Nigeria. Well, how do you diversify the economy without having a paradigm shift from your number one oil earner, which is oil, which in itself is going out of fashion across the globe? So many countries are not buying oil again. So agriculture would have been the main key. But what do we do? I was so surprised when I had some few days back when I heard that we are importing palm oil. Palm oil. If you go to my village in the Imo State, if you see what we do with palm oil, we have so much palm fruit. What in those states? There's so much you can do. We can do. But the palm fruit, the Malaysia, which is one of the number one exporter or producer of palm oil, came to Nigeria in the 60s to take our palm oil fruit to Malaysia. Now they are number one in the world. I don't even know which number we are. So that is the problem we have. And it all boils down to leadership. Those we have at the helms of affairs next to nothing about how to go about leadership. And that to me is where we find ourselves, and it's rather unfortunate. But we can still do the needful if we do the right thing and get it going.
All right. Let's talk a little bit more security now. There's something about a Berlin Wall here on the Daily Independent. It says on insecurity, we need Berlin kind of walls, at our Navy, or at our borders, rather, Navy tells reps. So I want to quickly share your thoughts on the efforts we've put into securing Nigeria's borders in the last decade or more, you know, and if we truly should be talking about building a Berlin Wall around Nigeria.
To me, that is laughable. Berlin Wall. Where are you going to put the wall? In Sokoto, or in Niger State, or in Imo State, in my state, or even Edo State, or where are you going to put the wall? It's just laughable. Even the Berlin Wall collapsed. Didn't you see that the Berlin Wall collapsed? Didn't you see that the wall collapsed and the Germany was unified? The fall of the Berlin Wall was what brought about President Merkel. You know, she used to be from the East, Eastern Germany. Yeah. And that is what we are talking about. When the war collapsed and West and East decided to come together again, and they felt that, the East have been surcharged in leadership in Germany. So they voted for somebody from the Eastern part. And that was Angela Merkel, who had come out to be one of the best leaders that Germany had ever had, although her party just was narrowly. And just the election just completed. But back to the issue is not war. You can be war, but when you're not talking of war, I don't even know. Are you okay? Let's start with Benin now. By the time you build a war within that Cotonou, what happened to the Ogun? You know, there's another entry point at Ogun where people smoke good things and stuff. What we need is sophisticated equipment to be able to have an aerial view of our borders. That is what happened across the globe. Even Donald Trump was trying to beat the world, the U.S., for 4 years. Was he able to beat the world? He just tried his best. Along the Mexico, you remember the campaign, his campaign slogan, that he was going to beat a wall within the Mexico border. How many did we? What we still need is a holistic approach to border security, manning our borders. Aerially also, we should be able to do that. But the fact is that we have one of the most porous borders in the world. Anybody can walk into Nigeria from anywhere without any problem. So what I should be thinking is that, if the House of Reps that said that, what I should be thinking is that, making sure that they budget enough for the immigration services, the police, and the other relevant agencies that we're able to man our border better. If we're going to build a wall, my brother, forget it.
Mm. Still on that Daily Independent, there's a story there, and it says $600 billion siphoned from Nigeria from 1960 to date. And that's a statement by the former External Affairs Minister during General Ibrahim Babangida's regime, Professor Bola Akinyemi. Now, he basically went on to detail the issues of illegal and illicit financial flows in Nigeria since from 1960 to date, Nigerians, politicians, and foreign companies that are in Nigeria are complicit in siphoning money out of Nigeria in their hundreds of billions. So he also talked about Nigeria's borrowing, you know, to fund our infrastructure and all of that, to say that if we can actually cut these leakages in our finances, we wouldn't need to borrow. Do you agree?
Well, that point, yes, I agree with you. On the first, siphoning money is not something that is new. It started from our independence when we took over reign of government from British and from across board. Don't forget that part of what led to the Isha insurgency in this 1964 Republic was that the killing and rest of it was because of the army accused the politicians there of corruption and rest of them. So it's not something of today. Yes, I agree. The Nigerian money is being siphoned, especially by politicians, and with the aid of other agencies. But don't forget that, is the government doing the right thing? I'm still back. Most of when I talk about the current government. I don't want to be talking about the past, because the past is behind us. For you to be able to learn what we have to focus on today and also the future. So in as much as the essence of history is to look at the past to be able to better today and tomorrow. But let us also situate the situation as it. Now, let us even start with the most recent. A report of the rot in the NDDC has been submitted to the federal president. Till now, the federal government is still studying that report. Serious, it wasn't billions. Trillions of naira were siphoned and stolen by certain individuals, which would by now expect the federal government to look at the report and publish the names of those. And those five poor people should be arrested immediately, tried, and jail. Until we start doing that, the issue will be paying lip service to the issue of corruption. And that is a problem. And it's not only there, across board. Most of this money that we are stealing can be used to better the infrastructure in Nigeria. Look at the state of our roads, terrible. Look at the hospitals, terrible. Look at the state of education, terrible. In what, which area can you pinpoint and say that we're making progress? None. So apart from bad leadership, our second problem is that of corruption. And the government, especially the president, Muhammadu Buhari, during his campaign, said that he's going to tackle corruption effectively. In fact, it was one of the reasons why Nigeria's government was because of insecurity, feeling that being a former general, he'll be able to handle insecurity properly. Then the second is the economy, corruption. But now, what do we have? Even the money that we recovered from abroad, I was telling about, what did we use them for? Have we been able to account for the ones that we recovered? My sister, is a long walk for us.
All right. Chris Wando, thank you very much for your time this morning. As always, we enjoy your perspective on national issues. And we wish you a very interesting Tuesday ahead.
Thank you
very much for having me, and do have a nice day.
You too. Stay with us. When we come back, we're going a little bit back in history to share with you what happened on this day, the 28th of September, many years ago.